thank you so much for watching my YouTube channel. Of course, I want you to subscribe. Seriously, this is fun, amazing, and jokes. Oh my gosh, we love the jokes at the end. Okay, maybe not. I want to finish our series, Jesus in Skin. And really, I think there's a powerful series because we're talking about and kind of framing this in the parable Jesus talked about with the prodigal son. And remember in this parable, if you read it in Luke 15, that Jesus' audience is two parts. The one group is the what I call the reprobates, all the sinners and the tax collectors. And then the other audience that he's talking to in verse 2, it says it that the Pharisees and the scribes, all the religious people, Jesus is talking to both audiences. And I appreciate that because you and I, we probably kind of bend towards one or the other. And sometimes we go through seasons and phases in our life, right? Where we might be more like reprobate. You know, the teacher gives us a coloring page and we color the table instead of the page. Whereas if we do it all right, maybe we color in the lines. Those are some examples. But really, I want us to be attentive today. Last week, we talked about the labor of love. This week, I want to talk about the language of love. Because in this parable, we read about a father who is very interesting in how he connects with the reprobate son, as well as the religious, self-righteous son. Because the language of love communicates with both. And whether you kind of bend, lean, maybe in this season in your life, you lean more towards one or the other. But the language of love is very important for us to think about and to consider as we understand Jesus expressing love to us. What is Jesus saying? What does love say to us? And in the language of love, I want you to consider verses 22, Luke 15, verses 22 to 24. And this is really powerful. The father runs out to the reprobate son who has returned from squandering all the wealth. You know, the parable is the youngest kid asks for the inheritance. He gets it. He squanders it on prostitutes and riotous partying living. He comes back because there's a famine. He doesn't have enough food. He's starving. And the father meets him from a distance, hugs him, embraces him. And this is the language of love. This is what love says to, in some respects, the reprobate, the renegade son. Verse 22, it says, the father said to his slaves, quickly, bring out the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand, sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf, kill it. Let us eat and celebrate. For the son of mine who was dead has come back to life and he was lost and has been found. The language of love. The language of love says, welcome home, son. Welcome home, daughter. I don't care what you've done. I don't care what you look like. I'm going to reconcile you. I'm going to redeem you. I'm going to bring you back into my family as my son, as my daughter. You don't need to ostracize yourself, exclude yourself, and punish and all this stuff. I am saying, welcome home. And the father says that to those of us who are reprobates and who aren't doing it right and we missed the boat. And you're like, yeah, I screwed up bad, bad, bad. And God says, the father says, the language of love says, welcome home. Welcome home. I'm here to restore you. I'm going to put a robe on you so you don't have to be embarrassed and ashamed and naked and in that vulnerable, shameful state. I'm going to put a ring on your finger that says you belong. You're with me. I'm going to kill the fattened calf because it's a party. I'm so glad you're here. And you can think in your mind, I don't deserve it. I'm not worthy. I should be, you know, all this. But the Father, the language of love says, welcome home. But I also want you to know that the language of love speaks not only to the reprobates and everybody who's screwed up and totally, totally done it wrong. The language of love also talks to everybody who's done it all right. Those of us who are religious and maybe we've been, quote, self-righteous, there's the language of love talking to us as well. And this is the older son who has excluded himself. Once the older son hears the partying and all the stuff going on at home, he comes and he's about ready to go in the house and then he finds out, oh, my little brother came home. The one who wasted all of our inheritance on prostitutes and right, he's back home. And the older son is resentful and angry and upset. And I want you to appreciate this is what happens with the older son. In verse 29, the older son says this to his dad. For many years, I have been serving you and I have never neglected a commandment of yours. And if you look at the language there, it's not love language. I've been serving you. He doesn't talk about being a son. He talks about being a servant. He talks about keeping commands. And for the older son, this is a transaction mindset. I do it right, so I should get these things. And he did it wrong, so he shouldn't get these things. It's very transactional. There's not intimacy, there's not connection. There's quid pro quo. And I want to encourage you that the language of love, genuine love, goes past transaction and quid pro quo. Because the language of love, the father talks to the older son. And he says this. He says in verse 31, the father says to him, son. He doesn't say servant. He says, son, you have always been with me. And all that I have, all that is mine, is yours. You belong. You're not a servant. You're not excluded. You're not qualified because you did everything right. You are always mine. You're always my son. You're not a servant. Everything I have is yours. Everything. But we have to celebrate and rejoice because this brother of yours, I think that's super important because some of us who are more a little bit self-righteous, sometimes we can have a negative outlook on those who are reprobates. We think we're better. And really what the father says here, the language of love says, equal. This is your brother. This is your sister. He belongs, she belongs every bit as much as yours, as you belong. And we are family. And this is so important. This is so important because in Romans 8:16, it says, Holy Spirit bears witness with your spirit inside that you are God's son. You're God's daughter. And that's true no matter what you've done wrong, no matter what you've done right. The language of love says you belong. You're with me. You're my son. You're my daughter. No matter what you've done, no matter how well you've done, you belong because of God's decision, because love goes after you, the labor of love. And really, God says, you're here. And that's what God communicates to you day in and day out and wants to say to you, your heavenly father, Jesus in skin, saying, you belong. You're a son, you're a daughter. Not because of your efforts and all the right things and not excluded because you didn't do it right. You belong because God says you're mine. You're my son, you're my daughter. And God's mindset towards you is genuine love. First and foremost, genuine love. So the language of love says, be reconciled. Be reconciled. Come back. Come into the house. Be part of the family. And you have a brother that maybe you don't like as much. You have a brother that maybe is super, you know, did it all right, high achieve, whatever. But you belong. We're family. We're connected. And let's celebrate together. Let's celebrate the ones that have been reconciled, the ones that have been redeemed. Let's celebrate because we're family. We belong. We're in the family with God. God is our Heavenly Father, loves us deeply. So thank you so much for watching and subscribing. Hit the notification bell right there. That'll be really helpful. And I'd like for you to think about this. I'd like for you to think in your family, if you have siblings, what are the relationships you have with your siblings? You have good ones, neutral ones. And think about that for a little bit. Give me some feedback. Do you like your siblings? I like some. The other, you know. Just kind of think about that. Give me some feedback. That'd be awesome. And, of course, we have this magnificent joke, which I know you're like, this is not magnificent. And if you've watched any of these, you're like, these are abysmal. I know, we groan, but they're still fun. So what do you call James Bond? You know James Bond, right? Taking a bath? We call him Bubble 07. As opposed to 007, Bubble 07 taking a bath. I know, but next week will be way, way better. Thanks again. God bless.